Well, welcome everyone, and thank you for joining us for Taking Stock Live. I know I enjoy and learn in every one of these sessions as much as I hopefully you do as well. Today we have certainly our youngest speaker and most accomplished at his age speaker, Tanmay Bakshi, who is an AI ML expert, a TED speaker, author of, yes, three tech books and has over 300,000 followers on YouTube. So certainly someone who needs no introduction, but Tanmay, I'll let you introduce yourself and your background to the audience today.
Sure. Thank you very much, Shelley. I'm really glad to be a part. Thank you for inviting me to the show. I mean, as you mentioned, my name's Tanmay, and really what I love to do is I love working with technology, right? So I love being able to build new technology, apply it in fields where I think it can make an impact. And specifically, the technology that I'm really interested in is sort of machine learning and what lots of people would call artificial intelligence technology, applying them in fields like healthcare and education, but also making that technology accessible to a wider variety of people, right? Because I feel like, first of all, that technology needs to be accessible to developers, which is why I have a bunch of open source projects. I mean, as you mentioned, there's my YouTube channels, my books, and my workshops. But then I also feel like the average person also needs to be able to understand this technology better as well, which is why, you know, I like to share my knowledge sort of on a higher level and more simplified through resources like, you know, the keynotes that I do and the talks, these sorts of things, and of course, interviews like this one today. So I'm really glad to be a part. Thank you once again.
Oh, it's great to have you. So, I mean, your passion and your love for AI and ML comes through. Will you explain, you know, really why and where that passion comes from, just so that as we go through this interview, everybody's sort of on the same page?
Definitely, definitely. So to sort of start off, my initial passion for the world of machine learning was sparked off a couple of years ago when I saw the Watson computer system playing Jeopardy, right? And that was just immediately fascinating to me because I was like, you know, before then, back when I was 11, sure, I was working with tech. You know, I'd initially gotten into the world of programming back when I was around five, and that's when the fascination sort of sparked. But, you know, when I was 11 years old, even though I was working with technology, I thought it was really, in a way, rigid, right? Because you could tell the computer what to do, and you could do some incredible things with that. But the computer could never do things on its own, and that kind of annoyed me in a way, right? Computers could never adapt. They couldn't adapt to new things you throw at them. It's just the same old rules that you've programmed. Mm-hmm. So when I saw a computer system being able to understand not only natural language, but the kind of natural language that even stumps humans, that just immediately was fascinating to me. And I was like, I gotta know how that works. And so that's how I started diving into the world of machine learning, deep learning technology, and started to, in fact, actually create tutorials and different sort of content for developers to get into this kind of technology through my YouTube channel, Tanmay Teaches.
So I think one of the things I wanna hear you talk about, because I know I get questions a lot is, you know, of course, computers can do incredible things, but I think they're also can be scary too. Yeah. And sort of robots taking over the world. We've all seen the movies. You know, maybe you could talk a little bit about the societal impact of AI and ML and, you know, why is it so important for us to understand?
Sure, sure. So I feel like when it comes to machine learning in particular, you almost have to treat it a bit differently than you do other technologies, because the way that we view it is very much skewed from previous technologies, from previous depictions of this technology even, right? When it comes to technology in general, I feel like there's this sort of fear of change, and that's natural, right? Every living thing is gonna have some kind of fear of change. That's just our survival instinct, right? We don't wanna change. But then when it comes to technology, that sort of, in a way almost bumps up a level because a lot of people don't necessarily understand how technology works, and therefore you have a further, you know, sort of fear of that kind of change. And so first of all, you know, it's natural for us to be afraid of these new technologies that are coming out like every day, all these new advancements. And I feel like with artificial intelligence technology, we sort of have almost, we're in the wrong scenario when it comes to machine learning technology, because if you take a look at the past few decades, the kind of content that we've created sort of depicts artificial intelligence technology as, you know, super intelligent machines that humans create and cannot control. These are depictions that are not grounded in any kind of technical reality. The issue is that with machine learning technology today, we're able to achieve certain capabilities that we as humans previously thought required human intelligence, right? Mm-hmm. So we take a look at, for example, OpenAI's GPT-3 and these sorts of examples. And even though these are pretty simple, I mean, I say simple as relatively simple, like not absolutely simple. These are relatively simple statistical models of language, but they have these kinds of capabilities that almost in a way kind of fall in that uncanny valley where we as humans are like, we thought human intelligence was required to synthesize this kind of natural language. So if a machine's doing it, it's got to have human-like intelligence, even though from a technical perspective, it doesn't. It just looks that way because our minds are subconsciously biased to think that, right? So that's one end of the bias. And I feel like that really comes down from its roots in the fact that we subconsciously don't really know how to deal with technology in the brain, right? Like MRI scans have proven this. When we deal with technology, our brain treats, for example, a computer or your phone as another living being, right? The same parts of your brain that deal with social interaction light up. And your brain, as far as you're subconsciously concerned, is, you know, communicating with another living thing, you know, an actual living entity. So subconsciously, we're already biased to thinking that these things are actually intelligent. Slap on the name artificial intelligence and then slap on these capabilities, and you can see why this becomes almost a perfect storm for people to think, oh, we're heading in this direction, even though it's a completely different direction with the same sort of initial capabilities. Okay, so that's one thing.
Okay.
I would say, really quickly, the other end of this, though, which I feel like is also really important to cover, is that a lot of people also believe that machine learning and AI technology is capable enough to replace humans at a lot more tasks than it actually can, right? So, for example, it's going to replace all of our jobs, right? We're not going to have any work left to do.
Yeah.
That's not going to happen. You know, we still require that sort of creativity and imagination in a lot more fields than people realize that is unique to humans, right? Machine learning is meant not to replace work, but to redefine what it means to work, in my opinion, right? So it's all about reshifting that balance, making it so humans can focus on what we are actually naturally good at.
Such a great answer, both from like the human perspective of our brains not knowing how to, you know, ingest this technology, and also misperception of how the technology fits in. I've often wanted to rebrand it from artificial intelligence to augmented intelligence, because I think it is an augmentation,
yes,
of what humans can do.
Thank you.
So, speaking of what humans can do, I grew up in the retail business. In fact, when I was your age, I think I was actually working in stores, didn't have 300,000 followers on YouTube. But I am super passionate about both retail and consumer goods. So maybe, can you talk a little bit, as they're the largest employers in the world, private employers, talk a little bit about, you know, the impact of these technologies for retail and brands?
Definitely. So I feel like retail is one of those industries that, you know, it's been around for a very long time. They've had to evolve. They've had to, you know, keep up with all sorts of new technologies. And in a way, it's almost been surprisingly difficult for retail to do this. Yeah. And you know, I feel like one of my favorite examples, unfortunately, I'm forgetting the name, but, you know, a long time ago, there was I believe he was a famous economist, and you know, one of his famous quotes was that the internet's going to have no noticeable impact on the field of retail, and here we are today with, you know, almost all retail being somehow, you know, impacted by e-commerce, right? So being able to do things online electronically. Now, the thing about the world of retail is that when it comes to, like, at least being able to buy things and go to retail stores in person, people fundamentally prefer being able to do things online because humans are lazy, right? We always want to find the single easiest way out, even if that sometimes means that maybe we have to spend more, or maybe it's a little bit more inconvenient, as long as we can do things, you know, from the tap of a button on our phone, or even just tell a personal assistant like Cortana to get something done for us. As long as it means that it's convenient, sometimes we will take that route, even if, you know, it costs more, it takes more time, whatever. So if we take a look at why that is, it's because there are certain capabilities that are afforded to you when you're doing things electronically that aren't necessarily immediately afforded to you when you're doing things physically, right? And so one of the obvious ones that I would say to start off with is recommender systems, right? Because if you think about it, if things are happening on one centralized marketplace online, you instantly have access to, you know, billions of rows of data that can be used to build the best recommender systems, you know, that there are. And I feel like one of my favorite examples, actually, again, of just how important or just how much of a competitive advantage that data can be. I mean, think about how Spotify is able to, you know, hold its own against another completely different service, you know, on native platforms, things like YouTube Music or Apple Music, these sorts of things, right? How is Spotify able to do that? It's because they've had the data science teams and the data collection teams that have been collecting data for so long that, well, they just have so much data, they can build magical platforms. They can build, you know, an application that just never stops playing music for you, music that it knows you like. And so data can be a huge competitive advantage. And the first thing to think about is that, well, within the world of e-commerce, you have immediate access to data. And data lends itself to machine learning, because what are you going to do with data if you're not there actually deriving insight from it, right? At that point, it's useless. So that's where the machine learning technology comes in, right? It's all about being able to take data sets that you have that are usually just sitting in an archive drawer somewhere, but actually start to take it out and start to find insights within them via this pattern recognition technology that machine learning enables, right? Like, for example, when exactly should a certain product be going on sale to make sure that X person and X demographic that needs it actually goes ahead and buys this now? I've personally seen this a lot with, you know, different friends of mine buying different products on, you know, different retail stores online, how certain, you know, discounts will be conveniently applied at very specific times to get you to buy something, right? So there are all these different examples of how there are certain optimizations that are done within retail online. And now the challenge is, can we bring these to the store in person? Right. And this is where the machine learning really starts to kick in. The first thing that I'll say is that with machine learning, all businesses, and I feel especially retail, have started to notice that there is one thing that's really important that they should be doing, and that is collecting data. Right. So previously, maybe a couple of years ago, maybe in person, like retail stores, maybe the data wouldn't be not necessarily collected. Maybe it wouldn't be used or harvested in the right sort of ways. Now we're starting to see the shift towards, first of all, data in these stores being collected and aggregated in a very certain way. Right. Like I remember a couple of years ago, the only sort of way I would think of Walmart was just, you know, the grocery store that I go to, and there's McDonald's there. but then I was invited to their headquarters in Arkansas, and I got to do a talk there, and I saw that they're actually more of a technology company than they are a retail or grocery company, right? And they actually have so many resources invested in cybersecurity to protect their data and the data centers to store and process that data, because that's their competitive advantage. They know when to ship things where, they know how much to price things in certain areas to make it so people buy, right? So the first thing is definitely data and compute power. The second thing I would say is that we're starting to see some of these capabilities from e-commerce sort of bleed into retail stores as well, right? So like another great example, I think, is like, for example, with iPhones. If you were to walk up to a retail store in person nowadays, in a mall, for example, and if your phone recognizes that you've walked up to a certain store and your phone's wallet contains a gift card, it'll actually send you a notification and say, hey, you've got a gift card for Best Buy and you're standing right outside of a Best Buy. Do you want to use your gift card? Right. And so now your phone is actually actively telling you, hey, there's a retail store beside you. Did you need anything from there? And that forces you to think, right? That sort of adds towards the sort of challenge of how do we get a customer in the store in the first place, right? So that's one thing. So overall, I feel like machine learning's role in retail, at least from a consumer standpoint, right? So this is the consumer standpoint, is making things convenient, making it so the consumer doesn't need to think, making it so the technology can do the thinking for you, right? Which, you know, there's you know, pros and cons to everything, but in this case, it's a win-win scenario because on one hand, you've got the consumer who's now getting the products that they actually need, right? And at the same time, you've got the retail store that's able to optimize this whole pipeline, right? And actually deliver those products from the people who are making them to the consumers that want them. I feel like, I mean, obviously within supply chain, the whole idea of efficiency is lots and lots of micro optimizations that add up to efficiency at scale, right? You know, a little bit of money saved over a year is going to add up to millions worth of dollars saved, right? So then you start to take a look at, for example, UPS. being able to do intelligent routing, right? With delivery, last mile is always the most expensive, right? It's almost counterintuitive in a way at first, but you look into it, and obviously the last mile is the most expensive for delivery. And so if you can optimize even a little bit of that with more intelligent route planning, for example, well, UPS can do that with machine learning now. They can make it even so that their trucks have to take as few left turns as possible, right? They go down to that level with the optimizations to make it so they can get trucks from warehouse to person as quickly as possible and as efficiently as possible. So I feel like there are all sorts of examples of where machine learning sort of impacts. And I feel like on a consumer standpoint, it's all about convenience. It's all about how can we make it so the customer has to do the least things and has the least friction from actually ideating that I want this, or even before that, you know, you don't know that you want something, to actually getting it. Right? How do you reduce that friction? And then on the back end, it's all about how can we make things more efficient, from, you know, route planning to cost, to predicting, you know, what things are supposed to be priced at, all these sorts of things. So it's all about reducing friction and increasing efficiency.
Yeah, really well said. And there's been a sort of long debate on the consumer side in the retail community about like what's cool versus creepy. And yeah. I think to your point, it's cool when you go to a store and you're reminded of a value. I will poke a little bit in that. I think that actually personalization expands beyond kind of price. I think giving great experiences, people who want to know more about products, giving great services. I think it's beyond convenience, but the data is the gold mine.
Maybe if I were to sort of extend that. Yeah. I feel like while convenience is, I mean, as you mentioned, one of the prime things, there's also the experiences in general that it enables. But even that, at the end of the day, somehow boils down to a more convenient lifestyle in a way, right? Like, I feel like maybe a good example would be augmented reality, right? Yeah. Like, for example, furniture, right? Furniture retail. You mm-hmm. know, one of the most popular examples of augmented reality ever, like this is like the default example that people point to, is you download the IKEA app and you pop up the little augmented reality explorer, and suddenly you can place chairs in your living room and take a look at what it's going to look like, right? And that's the classic AR example. But without machine learning technology, again, that wouldn't be possible. Like modern AR technology, think about how, phones with two cameras, for example, how are they figuring out depth to enable AR to happen? Well, that is machine learning powered. Parallax without machine learning, not particularly accurate, right? So, without the data that we're capturing from all these devices and without the machine learning technology to actually leverage that data, those sorts of experiences aren't possible. So I agree with your point.
It's not I would argue, especially for consumers of your generation, sustainability and transparency around, where products come from, how they're made, the sourcing and is increasingly important. So the connectivity between the consumer and the supply chain and the visibility is a really important frontier for retailers and brands.
Absolutely.
So let's talk a little bit, because we've all read about the sort of like 30 years of e-commerce growth in 3 months in COVID-19. What kinds of trends are you seeing in terms of the current pandemic and what's happening in this area that you're so passionate about?
So what I would say is that I feel like COVID has almost forced us to innovate. and it's you know, people would say that it's forced us to change, but I feel like it's almost a lucky coincidence in a way that it's forced us to innovate, not just change, right? So we haven't just been forced to shift from physical to digital. We've been forced to improve digital enough to actually encompass the advantages of physical as well, right? Because that's sort of where we're at with COVID. And I would say actually, maybe we should start off with an analogy from the field of education. Okay. So, you know, if you would have said before that, you know, the field of education, you know, students K to 12 are going to be taught completely virtually, maybe a week before the whole sort of lockdown stuff happened, people would have said that you're crazy, right? That's never going to happen, right? That would have been insane to think about.
Yeah.
But then you take a look at today and suddenly, yes, everything is virtual. I mean, some things are starting to transition back to physical, but at the end of the day, things are still virtual. And we've had to innovate in the sense that we can't just, you know, slap Zoom on the problem and consider the problem solved, or Microsoft Teams in this case, right? We've got to really think, how can we enable a good experience on those platforms, right? And that's why we've seen all these different updates to, you know, machine learning powered features, including on these platforms. So that's one thing. We've been forced to not just change, but also innovate and push what's possible. because we have to, right? There's no chance for us to, you know, go back doing things in person again, at least for some time. So we've been forced to change. And I think within retail, again, it comes back to the experiences that you were mentioning, right? So I mentioned being able to reduce friction. But then again, the experiences also have to change. And with COVID, they have, right? I feel like, again, augmented reality is actually a great example of this, right? What I was just saying around being able to sort of combine the advantages of a physical and digital. You know, lots of new phone launches have happened in the past couple of weeks. Yeah. And across different brands, actually, this used to just be a couple, but across different brands now, you can go to their websites and you can download an AR file for the phones and actually look at the phone in person, sort of on your desk. What would it look like? How does it reflect in your environment, right? How you can actually take a look at these things, and that's only possible thanks to machine learning technology. At the same time, I will say that machine learning has also helped with the availability of resources in certain areas. Right. Mm-hmm. So this almost comes back down to the efficiency point in the sense that this is a challenge that I'm very passionate about solving. And the challenge is that right as this sort of pandemic hit and the lockdown hit, the distribution of the data that we feed into these machine learning models changed very, very much. Mm-hmm. And humans are surprisingly predictable. So, you know, I feel my favorite example was this one time. And when our predictability sort of shatters because of some sort of external variable, in this case, COVID, machine learning models don't cope very well because they've been trained on a very specific distribution of data. Yes. And the thing about machine learning models is that they're not humans. Remember that, right? Even though some of their capabilities look human-like, they're not. And so when we sort of shift that distribution and suddenly we're slightly outside of the, I guess you could say, and this is almost humanizing it, but the comfort zone of these machine learning models, suddenly we start to get very bad predictions. Now, I will say that luckily, of course, a lot of large companies have been able to figure out how to work around this. And they were able to pretty quickly within the course of like 2-3 weeks, get their machine learning models back on track, mostly because of the fact that they were collecting enough data over those 3 weeks. But it took time. And so that's something that we should keep in mind is that if data distributions change wildly, we need to have, I guess, fail-safes in a way to prevent us from just saying, oh, well, no, it's not working anymore. Because if machine learning models are the infrastructure for society to do everything from buying essential supplies to even entertainment, right, that whole spectrum, then we've got to make sure that it's reliable and robust across scenarios. So I would say that one of the challenges that I'm really passionate towards working on is solving that problem of robustness and being able to handle those sudden shifts out of nowhere, because that's where the real value comes in, right? That's definitely one of them. But overall, I would say that there are all sorts of experiences that we've had to innovate that we wouldn't have because we didn't have the incentive to before COVID, right? Or maybe if we did, we would have done it at a larger time scale, right? This has forced us to do it quickly.
Yeah, no, it's true. I actually had one of our customers grab that that runs in mostly in Southeast Asia. They're like the last mile delivery, like an Uber almost. But they said to me, you know, COVID is the new chief innovation officer. And it just to your point, has taught us what we are capable and how quickly we can move.
Exactly.
So how about you? I mean, you seem like you have such a bright and inspiring future and vision ahead of you. What are you going to be up to in the foreseeable future?
Well, thank you. So, I mean, first of all, as I mentioned, I'm really passionate about, mostly two things. First of all, building new technology, right? Being able to research new impactful technologies that can really, you know, save and augment people's lives is the idea. And at the same time, I'm also passionate about making it so that people understand the technology, both from a technical perspective for developers and also just from a sort of impact and societal perspective for the average person that doesn't need to care about the technical details, because, you know, we all at the end of the day are decision makers. And if we're not making the right decisions about technology, which happens to be the infrastructure on which our lives are built, that's not a good thing. So That's first of all what I'm passionate about. So I sort of want to continue to work towards scaling these initiatives up, right? So for example, when it comes to the sort of technical angle of this, I have this goal of reaching out to 100,000 aspiring developers to help them, learn how to code and get and sort of help them across their journey of working with the world of tech, which is why, of course, I've been working towards the books that I'm writing and the workshops that I do in my YouTube channel, Tanmay Teaches. So I'm going to continue working towards that and scaling that up. At the same time, going to also continue making more resources for people to understand this technology from a less technical perspective. But also, I do want to continue working towards actually applying this technology in fields like healthcare and education, where it can make such a large impact, right? Because if we take a look, these are fields that are prime for disruption, right? We've got lots of data, we've got lots of really old legacy processes that need to be updated, right? And overall, the education, I mean, for example, within the field of education, we're literally teaching the next generation of humans that are going to solve the world's problems. Of course, we want to be able to make that as good as possible so that we have the best problem solvers in the next generations. And with healthcare, we are literally saving people's lives if we're applying efficiencies throughout the pipeline. So I feel like those are a couple of the main things that I want to continue to work towards. There are a couple of projects that I'm working on today that I think are going to be really impactful to work towards these goals. So that's what I'm working on, and I can't wait to be able to scale this up even further.
That's amazing. I mean, certainly healthcare and education are two areas that need your help and need bright minds like you to really work at it. So you said if folks who are watching us today want to learn more, is it Tanmay Teaches, or where do they go to learn more about what you're up to?
Yes. So my YouTube channel, Tanmay Teaches, is a great way to sort of take a look at the different projects that I'm working on. Of course, there's also my books under the Tanmay Teaches series that I'm working on. So that's there, as well as my social media, Tadgy Manny on Twitter and Instagram, as well as my LinkedIn.
Well, Tanmay, thank you so much for tuning in today and being my guest. It was incredible. I learned so much, and I'm sure our audience did too. So for all of you who either have tuned in for the first time to Taking Stock Live webcast or have watched a couple of our other speakers, please know that we have more incredible thought leaders coming really across the field of technology, retail, consumer goods, and real visionaries that have inspired me my whole life. So please tune back in, always share your feedback, and thanks again, Tanmay.
Thank you very much, Shelley. Glad to be on the show.